12 years ago, I was right here in your shoes as you are today, and I had absolutely no idea what I was going to do after I graduated, which probably is what most of you are probably thinking as well. So studying engineering, it teaches you, prepares you for many things. It's very diverse. It teaches you a number of problem-solving skills in a number of technical subjects. But what it doesn't prepare you for is what happens when you walk out that door for the first time, and where do you go from here? So as most of you are come straight out of school, you went to primary school, high school, university, you're kind of in that structured environment, right? You're thinking, there's a plan, someone set a path for you. But when you walk out that door for the first time, it's the first time you're actually going to have to think for yourself. And that can be a little bit of a daunting experience. So this is why I'm here to tell you how you can deal with that. So my final year project was largely focused on computational analysis of wear using microabrasion using a 3D laser microscope. That's a lot of words. But I chose that project because computations at the time was my best subject. And I enjoyed computer programming, and I enjoyed computer simulation. And as a result, I got a high distinction for that project, and I got the top marks for the presentation for that year. This basically laid out the foundation that if I was truly going to be successful, that I had to specialize in topics that I most was passionate about and that I truly loved. After graduating, I started knocking on a few doors in a number of different industries, trying to see where I could apply this skill set of mine. And I came across the visual effects industry and was surprised that they used computational models to simulate structural behavior, but for entertainment purposes. If you've ever used Strand 7, how many people have used Strand 7 here? Yeah. Okay, so you might have done bridge simulations with a wind load or structural bending based on a load, that kind of thing. So in visual effects, we essentially do the same thing, but kind of the reverse. We produce the simulation, but adjust the parameters to get the desired effect. If that makes any sense. So I got in contact with the head of research at Animal Logic. Animal Logic is Australia's biggest visual effects house in Sydney. And I introduced myself, and I sent him an email and said, hey, I'm an engineer. I'm interested in this industry, and is there a place where I can apply my skill set? And he came back with one line in the email, and he said, come and see me first thing in the morning. I went to see him, and Guy, as an engineer himself, has told me that he has been working towards those models in the industry himself, and that the technology has been in its infancy, and it hasn't been investigated to its full potential. He then went on and told me that Animal Logic won a $100 million contract with Warner Brothers to produce Australia's first animated feature film, which we now know as the Academy Award-winning Happy Feet. He told me that day, if I was interested, I could be part of that project, and within 24 hours, I had my new career. I worked on Happy Feet for 3 years, and in that time, I got to meet a lot of interesting people from all sorts of diverse backgrounds. 600 individuals from all over the world who came from studios like Pixar, DreamWorks, Sony, Warner Brothers, and Weta Digital. But what interested me about it the most was how diverse the group of people were. They were a group of visual effects artists, animators, scientists, mathematicians, and software engineers, and no other industry that I could think of could encompass such a diverse group of people that still had to work closely with each other and still speak the same language. So that was really interesting to me. I developed many of the visual effects tools used on the production to simulate water, waves, and even simulating the fur on penguins ruffling in the wind. I worked on tools to simulate splashes, snow kicks, and even shifting of the body weight as a character moved. These are things that you might take for granted when you're watching the film, but that's the whole point of this industry. If you were to notice these things, then we weren't doing a good job. By the end of the production, I got a call from Sony Pictures in LA, and they said they heard about my work and were interested in bringing me over for an interview. The next thing you know, I was on the next plane to LA. During 5 years of working at Sony, I worked on the animated films Beowulf, Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, and Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland. I worked on what is now the industry standard ray tracing renderer called Arnold, In a ray tracing renderer, visual imagery is represented by real-life optics to path trace light rays. Virtual light is bounced around in 3D, scattering through virtual materials defined by a set of computational instructions which force them to behave as if they would in real life. This gives the illusion of real-life shadows, reflections, refractions, and opacity without the need of an artist actually painting all those specific details. After Sony, I moved on to work for Disney Animation, and I had the pleasure of working on the animated features Tangled, Wreck-It Ralph, and Frozen. How many have heard of Frozen? Yes. Frozen has become the most successful animated film of all time. It went on to win 2 Oscars, one for Best Original Song and the other for Best Animated Feature. And believe it or not, that was the first Oscar for Disney for animated feature, even though they had produced 53 beforehand. The reason was the category was only created in the year 2000. Frozen was also the 5th highest grossing film of all time, with total box office earnings of almost $1.3 billion. And that doesn't include the merchandise or other licenses, that's just ticket sales for the movie itself. With the complexity of animation and demand for the detail on the rise, the need for procedural animation became more and more realized. So you can hand animate a couple of characters and you could model a few buildings here and there, but once you started to talk about building an entire city full of cars and people, you can't possibly hand animate all that detail. So you had to think about things a little bit differently. And this is what we did on the upcoming animated feature, Big Hero 6. Big Hero 6 is the 54th animated feature film from Disney and is also the most technologically complex animated film ever created. For the first time, we had to build an entire city of people and traffic, so much so that we had to develop entire new technologies to achieve the director's vision. We built our own ray tracing renderer called Hyperion. It's similar to Arnold, but the big difference is that it was capable of consuming enormous amount of geometry. We wrote software to artificially create cities based on a handful of parameters like street intersections, building heights, number of windows and doors, and so on. And Disney even set up an entire department that would focus purely on procedural animation of the background characters and traffic. Disney called that department the crowds department, and I was made the supervisor. I was assigned a team and made in charge of working with the director to ensure that we can bring that city to life. As the first ever crowd supervisor at Disney, I was in charge of determining how to create artificial people and traffic in the city without the need to hand animate. For the first year of working on Big Hero 6, we did a little bit of research into vehicle automation and came up with a system that would artificially move cars around the city with respect to traffic lights, braking, slowing down, speeding up on highways, slowing down, and even signaling when turning corners. We did research into crowd behavior, and we found computational models based off a mixture of fluid dynamics and psychology to replicate human behavior in groups. Whenever we wanted to see thousands of people moving in a group, for example, we found that we can get pretty realistic simulations by treating them like fluid particles with boundary conditions. Yeah, people move like fluids. I was fortunate enough to be assigned a very intelligent team, a team of artists and scientists that helped me make the department a success. And I had the honor of presenting that work to Lucasfilm, Pixar, and even NASA. Big Hero 6 had just been released in the US a couple of weeks ago and opened number one in the box office, with $56 million in its opening weekend, which actually beat Chris Nolan's Interstellar, which opened the same weekend. Big Hero 6 will be released here in Australia on Boxing Day, and I urge you all to go and see it, not just because it's a Disney animated film and because I worked on it, but because of its sheer technological innovation. So, where do I go with all this? Looking back on my career, I've been trying to analyze how I got this far, because I personally am interested in how I got this far, and how I can leverage off what I learned so I can move forward. Some people might think that there was a bit of luck involved, but it's not as much as you think. So there was a few things that I did for certain that increased my chances for success. The first and foremost is that you have to be loyally passionate about it, about what you like. You have to really genuinely enjoy what it is you do. And you have to truly dig deep and understand the subject down to its bare bones. Once you have that, then that's when the true ideas start to flow, and that's how you become a visionary. once you have something, it's not a, once you have something, it's not out, and it's not, it's also not enough to go out there and do it. You also have to learn to sell it. You have to be able to convince people that what you have is important. Sales is actually a big part of the job. You're not just selling a product, you're selling ideas, and you're selling a product with your own experience and knowledge. So you, one thing you need to do is learn to be able to sell well, which obviously you guys are going to be doing today with your projects. Think beyond the tasks that you're given. You need to be able to have the courage to challenge preconceived ideas with your own bosses. Think outside of the square and be forward thinking. Think about where your industry is going and what you can bring to the table to drive some innovation. Also focus on finding a specialization that can give you a competitive edge. And finally, there's networking, and it's not the Hollywood type. Networking is getting to know your coworkers and industry peers. The more you interact with your peers, the more you can learn from them, and the more that they can see what you can offer to them. The larger your network, the higher your chances your ideas will get noticed. And this is not just within your workforce, but within the industry as a whole. So these are some of my notes, and I hope I gave you guys enough of a pep talk, and I wish you guys luck in your final year presentations. I personally wasn't involved in it, but I had to play a part in it in the sense that I had to advise the technology team on how many processors we would need to be able to consume all this data. As the crowd supervisor, I was actually responsible for a big chunk of that data. So all those people and traffic, they obviously required a lot of computational time. The issue with Big Hero 6 was we had what you call a compressed schedule. Normally, a film, if a story goes well, normally it takes about 2 years to develop. And as we are developing that story over the 2 years, usually we can push sequences into production as we go. And so we don't need that much computer power as we move, as we're going through the production. The issue with Big Hero 6 is the story came in very, very, very late in the game, in the last 6 months. And so in 6 months, we had to come up with a way to basically render this entire film in one go. So we ended up having to talk to people at Pixar, Lucasfilm, Sony, and we had to borrow procs from all places, I think even Amazon, so that we can actually pump this up. The other thing with ray tracing renderers as in general is that because it's all computationally intensive, you're basically calculating how light behaves at every pixel in the image. And the more you put, the more detail you put in, the more glass you put in, the more reflections you put in, the more that computation starts to skyrocket. When we really wanted to push this city through, we realized that there's no way that we could actually push this through without having the largest supercomputer ever created. So that's what had to happen. We had to spend a lot of money. It's classical CPU. The reason, I'm not quite specifically sure of the reason, I'm not in that department, but it briefly has to do with how efficiently CPUs carry out certain programmatical tasks versus a GPU. GPU is more better for real-time game engine stuff. For our kind of processing, we're mostly processing equations. And we're finding that CPUs are better for that. So, yes, there's Navier-Stokes. There's a number of fluid things. There's a lot of off-the-shelf stuff that basically simulates that kind of thing. But once we get into trying to get into that photorealistic detail, then we start to go and we talk to other universities and we work with them on building those models. No, it's not. Well, so we it's kind of funny. We actually push for accuracy first. So we want because the ultimate game is that we want this to look like a plausible real world. So we push for the reality first, but then the director wants something different. So So we'll push it as far as we can. But then because it's still an art directed film, and because the director has a specific vision, we'll always kind of dial that back a bit, and then we'll fake in certain things. And sometimes real life doesn't look as good on screen. it's kind of a funny thing. Like we might be able to simulate. Waves hitting in waves in an ocean and that kind of thing, but it might work really well from a specific angle, but then when you're trying to shoot it from a different angle from a different camera, it may not hold up that well. So we start to fudge the parameters a little bit. So the base equations are real, but what we actually do with them, the parameters that we actually manipulate, the boundary conditions we manipulate, that's kind of artist control, and so that's kind of how we work with film. Traditional animatronics. I think the film industry is definitely moving more visual effects, digital effects style. But what there is still a big need for is the parks. We work really closely with Disney Parks, and they're actually increasing their department, their mechatronics department, because they're finding that they want. As people are walking around the parks, they want to interact with these characters that they've seen on screen. They want to talk to them. They want to touch them, and that's not something that we can do. That's something that the robotics teams are really good at. So, yes, there is a future. May not be so much on the film side as much as it used to be, but definitely in other divisions. Yeah. So in the R&D stage, the first thing we look at is we look at the script. And we talk to the director, and we also talk to the art director. And the art director will actually physically draw what he or she wants to see. And it might be something completely absurd, and it's like, well, that's just plain impossible. But what we do is we try and take it, we look at what models we have, and we try and generate what the visual imagery that the art director wants from the models that we have. If we can't get that far, then we talk to research groups, or we talk within the group to see how we can manipulate those founding equations to be able to produce that art. Once we get to that stage, and we take it back to the art director, and we're like, this is, it may not be exactly what you're after, but this is as close as we can get, and then it's kind of a back and forth deal, and we go from there.